chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace.
Good evening, planet Earth, and welcome to the Good News Program. My name is Bill Robinson, and I'm your host for this evening's program. And with us, a very special guest. We're doing this in Cape Ann. And this young man beside me is no stranger to Cape Ann. He's a Gloucester guy, Jason Favazza. Thank you so much for coming down.
Bill, really. Thanks for having me.
Oh man, this is a real treat for us. When I see you, Jason, I just can't stop thinking about the mercy, the love, the faithfulness, the graciousness of God.
Absolutely.
Oh man.
Absolutely.
You know, it's off the charts. You can't. So describe it. But what I'm going to do, I'm going to call you Jay, because everybody else does.
Perfect.
Yeah. So I'm going to tell the people out there in television land a little bit what a testimony is. We did it last program, but sometimes people, they don't see the first program, they see the second program. So they say, what is this guy? You know, well, I want to give them a little bit of what it does. It reveals the nature of God. And how he moves differently in different people. I mean, we're all unique. So, and he's, you know, like, there's, you know, 139 billion planets or something. He's unique. But we are his biggest treasure. We are who he made. And he delights in us. And when people get you, as we get into this, you'll be able to see what we're talking about. You know, and it creates an expectation. It's really his story, but it's Jesus' testimony. And it is the spirit of prophecy, and it's not like what's going to happen 40 years from now. It's like a prophetic declaration that's been made over his life. And it creates an expectation for God's ways to be manifest in people's lives. That you're out there in television land, and you're looking at it and say, well, I don't know if I have those same issues that Jason had, but there's something about his presence resonates off him. There's something changed. There's something different here. And I'd like a piece of that action. Well, you know what God's saying? The word testimony in Hebrew means do it again. And that's what he wants to do. He does it again. And it has the creative power to bring what is declared here tonight into being. That's simple. And it is the power of creativity to transform the culture that we live in. So you're going to hear Jay's story from... you know, from cradle he's to where he is right now. So, and we always say, you know, who are you? Where are you? Why are you here? And what's going down? And that's what he's going to, that's basically the format that we operate in, you know. And it's interesting. And I find it riveting because, you know, you can go to church on Sunday, and that really doesn't make you a Christian.
Absolutely.
You know, if I move into the garage, I'm not going to come out in an automobile. If I stick my head in the pizza, in the oven, I'm not coming out of pizza, right? So there's a transition, there's a process that God uses, and it's different for everybody, but it's yet the same. You know, it's the cross that gets it. So I'm going to help you get started here, Jay.
All right.
Gloucester guy.
Yes, sir. Born and raised.
Born and raised. Yeah. Okay, tell us a little bit about your family growing up and stuff, you know?
All right. Well, I was born, I'm 33, grew up in Gloucester, Marchant Street, Friend Street, around the Destino's neighborhood for all you Gloucester folk. You know, grew up in a good family. Parents were divorced, but got love from both sides, mother and father. Instilled good moral qualities in me, you know, taught me to be the best person that I could, raised me with a lot of love, you know, sent me in the right direction, if you will. Somewhere along the line, I just kind of got my lines of communication crossed up and just ended up taking a road that I didn't want to go down, you know.
You went to high school here?
Yeah, I did. Graduated in 2001. Went to Gloucester High.
Interest while you were in high school?
Well, I was into sports big, you know, baseball, basketball, football. Played all through Pee-wees growing up. You know, that took a lot of my time and interest.
Yeah.
You know, liked spending time with the family. Had a lot of friends, a lot of good friends. You know, just did my own thing and just went the way of the world, really.
Yeah, I'm saying as a kid in high school, you'd have your athletic parties, we call them.
Absolutely.
And you get introduced to marijuana and stuff.
Yeah. Well, you know, everyone has this image of the way a jock mentality, if you will. You know, those are true. A lot of beer drinking parties. A lot of, you know, starting with drinking and marijuana, and then it just progressively gets worse. You know, as you move up, I just, you know, found the next thing that would just occupy my mind and just take me to that next level. And it was, you know, it's really funny how easy that it is.
Yeah.
You know.
When
you
yeah,
think
I know.
About it, it's sometimes you just lose that control if you have that addictive personality, and I just kind of fell right in the mold of it. You know.
Yeah. You know, and it's. We were looking out my kitchen window today, and I looked down. I can see the Stone Pier. And you said, "Oh man, I spent a lot of time there." So, you were a member of the Stone Pier Club.
Yeah, I spent a few nights down there. You know.
Yeah, a few, right?
Yeah.
And I think Mitchell, who directs this program, at one time was a card-carrying member, too.
I believe so.
Yeah. So, I mean, that was where West Gloucester relaxed.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So you're in high school, and you're interested in sports, and you get introduced to, you know, marijuana. And you know what, Jason? I tell you what. People say, oh, it's recreational. That's it. You know what? You know what? Where are you coming from? What planet are you on?
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
It leads the next step, and the next step. Oh, no, we just, you know, we get high on that. You know what? You're going to hear tonight. You can get high, but you get high on Jesus, and that's a real high, you know?
Absolutely.
So after high school, what did you do?
Well, I was working odd jobs, you know, just trying to make ends meet, you know, and as I got older, my drug addiction became more rampant.
What were some of the jobs you had? Because these people are saying, I saw that guy, I know him.
I worked at the YMCA.
Uh-huh.
I've done construction, landscaping. I've driven a taxi. I drove a taxi for a couple of the companies in Gloucester. You might have seen me around. You know, and I just, you know, that just kind of, I always was able to keep a job. You know, I kind of kept my addiction under wraps, or so I thought it.
Undercover.
Undercover, so
yeah.
I thought it, but, you know, people can tell. As much as you try to hide it, man, it just comes out, you know.
So some of your fares in the cab, they might say tonight, they'd say, whoa, I remember that guy.
Yeah, a guy might have been driving me, you never know.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, different person now, though, altogether.
Yeah.
You know, so.
So, okay, so. You're what, 23 years old, and you're
hitting
30, it? 33. 33, but yeah, 23, you're hitting it hard.
Absolutely, yeah. You know, like I said, what started with, you know, weed and alcohol at 23, even 21 for that matter, just progressed into a terrible opiate addiction, Perc 30s, OC 80s, all the way up to IV heroin use. To the age of 27, you know, I had a, like I said, I had a good family, great family, always had my back, always just worked with me in every situation, and I thought, I thought I could keep that drug use hidden from everybody, but the one thing that people forget is that when you start doing that stuff, it changes you. You know, I was no longer, my mom used to tell me all the time, you're no longer that funny kid with the great smile that used to come around and make everyone laugh. I was just like a former shell of myself, you know, and just the drugs had a hold on me. One of the people that I used to work for, when this stuff finally started coming out that I had some issues with it, he said, you know what, Jay, I love you, man, but they're telling me this heroin addiction's got a hold on you. And I finally said, you know what, you're right. And it just... You know, it took a lot to get me to finally give that up. You know, I was kicked out of house, kicked out of my uncle's house, my dad's house, my mom's house, friend's house, until there was, you know, rock bottom.
You're in the outhouse.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. No more houses to get kicked out of.
Okay. So then what happens?
So my sister and my mother kind of.
I love this part.
Yeah,
I love this. This is supernatural, divine intervention. You don't write this stuff in books. You can't imagine what.
Yeah, it's crazy. It's crazy how it works.
Yeah, it's great.
So I work for a place called Teen Challenge, affiliated with Teen Challenge Boston.
How did you get there, though? Your mother.
My mother and my sister came to me and said, "You need some help. This is what we want to do.
We want to
bring you to this program." And I said, "I don't want to do it." My mom said, "Well, listen. I met this lady 2 days ago, and she told me that her uncle runs this program. It's called Teen Challenge. Would you consider giving it a shot?" She said, "It's kind of like a Bible boot camp."
Whoa.
And I said, "I don't want to do that. Everything that I've ever heard about church or been to church, I didn't want anything to do with it moving forward." But at this point, I was so desperate, I just said, "You know what? Let's go ahead. Let's give it a try." So my mom met this lady who was the director's niece 2 days before. Rodney Hart's niece.
Wow.
And then she doesn't really have that much communication with her anymore to this day. So this lady was just placed in my mom's life at the perfect time, at the perfect situation to get me to go exactly where I needed to be at the time. Man, and if that's not God, I don't know what it is.
Yeah.
You know? But it's I still get goosebumps when I talk about it to this day because...
You're alive.
Yeah, absolutely.
What was the alternative?
It was either death or in jail, my friend.
Right.
We're talking about that. Yeah.
Where
I was at, you know, I was, you know, getting ready to either rob somebody or steal or hurt somebody or, you know, mostly myself, but...
Support your addiction.
That's right. Death or in jail was my next move.
So now you're in... Did you go to Brockton?
I went to Boston.
You went to Boston.
Boston,
okay.
Yeah.
That's over in... Bloomfield.
Bloomfield Street in Dorchester.
Yeah, I've been over there, yeah. You're going to hear how the program works from a guy that went through it and all the anxieties and fear and you know, he's being impacted by a completely different culture than he's used to. He's used to doing things his way all the time, and now they're saying, there's an alternative program here.
That's right.
Yeah. Bill, you're in the first day. Tell us about
it. All right. So Bill and I spoke earlier, and we talked about the culture change. Walking into a place like Teen Challenge, it's completely different from anything that I've ever known before. 27 years living one way of always looking out for yourself, and especially coming off of addiction where you're so selfish and so self-oriented and just trying to do everything for you and not caring about anyone else, to come into a place where... You walk in the door and a brother will come up to you and hug you and tell you that he loves you for no other reason that he's genuinely caring for you. And it kind of took me back a little bit. It took me a little while to get used to it. You know, and it took probably about a month and a half or so when I finally, confessed that Jesus is my Lord and Savior. And I just kind of broke down and got saved. It was probably a month and a half into the program. And, you know, it was one of the best days of my life looking back at it.
Well, you know, I can identify with Jay, because it was similar for me in a sense. And he used the word saved. And, you know, when I first came around like him, I'd say, "From what? What are you talking about? Saved from what?" You know, I those weren't words because of the tradition that we both were brought up in.
Right.
We never heard that. We never heard the thing, you know, the word born again. I'm saying, what are you ever talking about? But you know what really, what he's saying is, when he came to the end of himself and he said, "There's got to be a better way out there. I'm not so sure. I've been in this place for, what, a month and a half or something, and it's not computing. This is a whole different culture." But you know what? I tell people, Jay, they don't have to understand it. They drive cars and they don't know how engines work. But you have to, you know, and sincerely, you ask them, and then guess what? The revelation starts.
Right.
You start to get revelation about how much God really loves you, and that you're not a piece of crap. You're a human being who He created, to his image and likeness. Now, you can do what you want with that. You can put it in the corner and cover it. But he still put his mark on you. And when what Jay did, he just looked at that cross, and I know what he did, and said, you know what? You did this for me? You love me that much? Wow. I don't understand it, but come in my heart, you know, and it began to change.
Absolutely.
Go ahead. Tell us about a little changes. Yeah.
So I had two brothers that had prayed over me and played a real big part in my my walk to turning my life around. And they, you know, one of the things were that they prayed that that my heart would change. As they were doing it, I'm thinking, you know what, that's exactly what I need to do. I need to, like, refocus everything that I'm doing and just set it in the right direction. And I've been so thankful for that today. You know, it's just been great. It's been a tough journey, you know, but like it says, you know, we're going to go through trials and tribulations, mm-hmm. and those things are going to help and mold and shape us.
Yeah.
You know?
God's a big spin master.
Absolutely.
You know, the enemy means to destroy you, and he spins it.
Right.
You know, and it's like with your testimony. It's your testimony. The guy with the inoculation, that means the guy that studied books on top of books and concepts and ideas. But you had the experience.
Absolutely.
You know, and we're not pushing theological salesmanship here, an experience, an encounter with God. And, you know, we're going to tell you later how you can have one for yourself. And so he's a teen challenge, pursuing it, and they call it challenge because it is a challenge.
Yes, it is.
You're living with guys in very close quarters, and, you know, you stole my shaving cream, or you used my toothbrush, or, you know, this stuff. Hey, listen, we live on planet Earth. This is what happens, and you got to learn to ride the waves. Forget about it, you know? Like the guy in New York says, forget about it,
forget
dude.
Forget about
know?
It.
You got to forget it. And you got to, that grace that God has given you, that you extend to other people. You know, I was reading, it's in Matthew, I don't know, it's 5 or 18, when he talks about Jay, the guy that owes a ton of money, thousands of dollars to his work for. And he pleads, the guy's going to send him to jail until it's paid for, put his family in jail, and he pleads with him. He gets on the floor and pleads, and the guy said, okay, I'm going to write it off, all right? You're forgiven. You know, you're grateful for that. But then you go outside, and a guy owes you like $2,000 or $3,000, and you say, hey, dude, I want the money. Can you give me some time? You say, no. You're going to the house. That's it. You're done. You're finished. You're cooked.
That's a great story.
Yeah. You didn't extend grace. So you learn to extend grace in this life, you know. So people are living in close quarters. Mm-hmm. You learn to extend grace. I've been married 55 years, Jay. And I've learned to accept a lot of grace from my wife, who's a saint, you know, and I don't have to give much because she's next to perfect. I hope she's watching. We're going to have blueberry pie tonight anyway. But, you know, that's what God made marriage for. You bring two human beings that are not perfect together so that, you know, and then he's in the middle of this. A threefold cord is not easily broken.
That's right.
And you say, wow, you're going to grow. And you are getting married soon.
Yes, sir.
Come on, tell us about that.
About a month away, I met in this whole transformation that took place in Teen Challenge. We do this yearly retreat. We go up to upstate New York.
Oh, yeah.
We have chapel services, just a lot of fellowship with all the different centers out in just a nice environment. And I met a beautiful girl out there that I plan to spend the rest of my life with, you know, about a month away now. We've been engaged for almost 2 years. We met each other about 3 years ago at this retreat in New York, and it was, you know, I like to say it was love at first sight, you know.
Okay.
Just,
yeah.
It was beautiful, you know. But all this stuff today now, that's fallen in place in my life, I never could have imagined without, you know, without God.
Yeah. It wouldn't happen.
No, it wouldn't. No.
And she's a graduate of Providence.
She's a graduate of Providence, Rhode Island.
Wow.
Yep, the Teen Challenge Women's Center, you know, and it's just, I felt like it was ordained from the beginning when we first met, you know. Very happy, you know, we're in sync, you know, with personalities. You know, I'd like to start having a family. You know, I have these goals now in my life and just ambitions that I never had when I was, sticking a needle in my arm.
Mm-hmm.
Just thought that, you know, I was so selfish, and, you know, now God's taught me to be selfless and just think of others. And I feel like that's why I'm still at Teen Challenge, giving back and helping other people accomplish the same thing, you know. And these goals that I'm moving forward with, Teen Challenge is a big part of it. You know, I'd like to, help out as much as I can to try to give hope and just, show the joy and the peace that God's just given me, you know, and hopefully be a light to somebody else that needs it. That's why I still do it, you know.
Yeah, you're on staff. You've been on staff 4 years.
Yeah, a little over 4 years. Been affiliated with Teen Challenge for 6, staff for a little over 4.5. And a lot of people say that they're there to help the guys, but I think the guys that are going through the program are there to help me because it helps me remember where I was.
Yeah.
So it's kind of a give and take relationship, which is, you know, kind of what we need.
You got to give away what you can't keep in order to gain what you can't lose. In other words, you have to give away what God's given to you, mercy and graciousness to somebody else. And guess when you do that, it just fills the cup up to overflowing.
That's right.
And I don't know. I mean, in this crazy world that we live in, I don't know if the natural mind can ever understand that. But I know one thing. When you do what Jay did, you will begin to understand that. And it's like you're on cruise control, dude. We are high on Jesus. And, you know, both of us have been high on alcohol and pills and whatever. And you know what? It's you can't compare it. Just can't compare it. You know, and God, you know, like Jay, you talk about how you met your wife and all the circumstances and situations that surround it. Those are orchestrated by God. Because not only does he have a destiny for you, but he has a process.
That's right.
And he has a mission and a vision.
And a purpose.
And he has a strategy, and he has goals, and he has how to reach those goals. He's got them all written down. And when you seek his face, one at a time, he reveals it. You know, people are saying to me, how'd you get hooked up with this guy? How'd this happen? Let me tell you how it happened. I have these, you don't have any with us, but they're in the truck. I have these little tracks that I give out, that Mickey Mantle's picture on, and it opens doors. And that's really not part of this program to tell you that, but it does open doors. But I'm going into the store down the street from me last summer one day. And a guy that I know lives down the street, he's coming in. And I looked at him and I said to myself, Jay, you know, and I know Joel's gonna watch this, so Joel, you know what I said anyways. How you doing? Because he looked like he had lost a ton of weight. And I mean a ton. And he said, oh, I'm doing good, Bill. And I guess he must have read my mind because he figured, no, I'm not sick. I've lost weight. I said, wow, that's terrific. My next thought was, dude, what are you doing with your old clothes? Because this guy's a sharp dresser. I mean, he's on top of his game, Jay. And he looked at me and said, well, what do you mean? I said, well, you're not going to wear the what you used to wear. He said, right. I said, what are you doing with them? He said, I don't know. I never thought about it. I said, well, I got guys that can use them. He said, really? And so I told him about Teen Challenge. He said, wow, that's good. Let me go home and get. So that was in the summertime. About a month and a half ago, he calls me on a Sunday. He said, Bill, I got 2 garment bags full of beautiful clothes. They're all clean. They're all Brooks Brothers suits. He said, I want to bring him up, you know, and I said, fine. I call up over in Boston, and I was talking to you, Jay,
yep.
And he said, yeah, you know, and then, well, how are we going to make the transition? Because I really didn't want to drive to Brockton or Boston, and they said, no, we'll come pick him up. I said, well, if you're going to come pick him up, let's tell the people about what God's doing today,
amen.
How he's changing lives, and impacting it, you know? So let's go on TV. So we had Jonathan, who's the pastor down there, you know, and we kid with him. But he did a marvelous job. And Jay's over there. He's on staff. He's healed, delivered, and set free for today.
Amen.
You know, and tomorrow the clock goes off, and we'll do it again.
That's right.
You know, that's, and so I want to tell you, Teen Challenge is a program that, that it's not so much about teenagers. It's like the teenagers got they got messed up can go there, you know, instead of, you know, prison or things like that. And it works because it's Christ orientated. He makes a difference in your lives. And he's real. He's supernatural. No, you hear what Jay said. He isn't going down the road goose and butterflies in La La Land. No, that's not real. God is real. We live on planet Earth, you know. So we have to learn from him through his word how we can make it,
that's
you know.
Right.
So I'm going to take a minute here, Jay, and tell the people out there in television land, to all the buddies that used to go down the Stone Pier, all the people that you drove in the cab, all the people whose house you did the landscaping for, when they see you, they say, oh, my God, that's Jay. I remember that guy. Wow. And that's what happened to him? Yeah. Now, it's different for everybody else, but the basic core is the same, that Jesus loves you just the way you are, and that's the good news. And that's the Bible, and that's what it is. It's the Bible is the living word of God. And you know what? And when you have a change, you know, there's concepts and theories that we really have a lower nature. No, we don't. We're not created with a lower nature. We need to have our mind renewed. And in Ephesians 4:23, it says, I want the spirit of my mind renewed. And we put these things in, and our spirit gets renewed, and we get high on Jesus.
That's right.
You know, and it's amazing. So out there in television land, all you friends that have seen this, seen Jay before 6 years ago, 7 years ago, wow, you know what? You can have a piece of the action. It's easy. All you got to do is say, you know what? I like that. You ask for it. You just say, wrap your own words around this. Words to these effect. I'm sorry for screwing up, Jesus. I really am. And I'm sorry for not taking time to go deeper with my walk with you. I am really sorry. From now on, I want you to come into my life, invade my life, take it over, and you lead me step by step the rest of the way. That's what Jay did. That's what I did. That's what Mitchell did. He's behind the glass over there. We all did it. And you know what? I can tell you this. It works. It works. It works. And it's one step at a time. Jay, I got to thank you so much.
Bill, thanks for having me, man.
Oh, my God. Thank you so much. And listen, you have a great wedding, and you say hello to your wife for us?
Absolutely.
Well,
absolutely.
See what he does? He does good things. He's always good, and he does the impossible. And the cross is where it all takes place, and then he comes out. Daddy raises him out of the grave, and that resurrection power that he gave to Jesus, he gave to Jay, he gave to me, and we can use it. And we are significant.
Yes,
we are his kids.
Yes, we are.
All right, out there in television land, you have a great week. Love you till next week.
My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy. Amazing grace.